You're listening to Write On by Final Draft. This is the podcast where we talk to writers and everybody else in the business about screenwriting and anything else tangentially related to screenwriting. I'm your host, as always, Pete D'Alessandro, product manager here at Final Draft. And today we have a great guest on. We're talking to Kelsey Scott, and her credits include How to Get Away with Murder, Fear the Walking Dead Passage, 12 Years a Slave. And you've also seen her on Hollywood Girl, where she's also a writer. She also wrote a feature called Motives. Kelsey Scott, welcome to Write On.
Well, thanks, Pete. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you, too. So let's talk about how you got into the business. Did you start as an actor, and what inspired you to do that?
I did start as an actor, as a child actor. And honestly, when I started, I'm not even really sure I called it acting. I was... Perhaps my mother would say I was acting out, and she was looking for a way to kind of focus that energy, and we found the theater stages of Atlanta, and so that's where I started. I think my first performance might have been at 3. That was like a pageant. It got more serious around 6, and then I just, all through my high school years, I mean, I went to performing arts high school and ended up doing a sitcom when I was a kid, but it was all just kind of having fun. Not really thinking about it as a career path, just having a good time.
That's great. So then how did you actually make the transition into the business?
It was the sitcom, actually, which kind of, I don't want to say it fell into my lap because that's not quite the truth, but it certainly wasn't a traditional story. The way, because I was living in Atlanta, and I entered a contest where they were kind of looking for 4 kids nationwide to host some family time programming on cable. And so Showtime went to 36 states and held these big functions in malls and had like hundreds of kids come up and read a cue card and do a little bit of a talent. It was this big shebang. And from the 36 states, they chose state winners, and then they chose 4 national winners, and I was one of the national winners. They flew us and our parents all up to New York, and we shot these segments at the Children's Museum in Manhattan. And so one of the judges for the competition was the woman who became my agent, Nancy Carson. And so she was, again, judging the competition, and she comes down to the shoot, and she pulls my mom to the side, and she says, "Hey, you and Kelsey should come by my office." And we did. They shook hands, and I had an agent in New York. And so for a while, the auditions were in New York. I lived in Atlanta. So luckily, my mom had family in New York. So my agent would put together a whole bunch of auditions, and then my mom would put me on a plane, and I'd fly to New York, and I'd do all these auditions, and I'd get back on a plane, and I'd go back to school. And like I said, luckily, I was at a performing arts high school, so they just thought that was really cool and worked with me in terms of schoolwork. And one of the auditions was for the sitcom. And so before I knew it, my mom was taking a leave of absence, and I was living in California for a while doing the sitcom. So that was really, it was kind of crazy. And that was I had done professional theater, but that was certainly the leap into television.
Wow. How old were you at that time?
11, 12.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
So early start.
Yes.
What about writing? When did you, that's obviously something you take seriously. When did that start?
Absolutely. I always loved it. It was always something that I gravitated toward. But when my grandmother moved in with us when I was 6, I believe, after my grandfather passed away, my grandmother, I think if she had the same sorts of choices that I do in life, or my sister did, even that my mother did, she would have been a writer professionally, but she didn't. So it became a dedicated hobby. I don't even want to call it a hobby because it was much more important to her than that. Hmm. But when she moved in with us, she was always writing. Wow. She was always writing, and she was writing poetry and plays, and for me, eventually speeches. It's kind of actually how I stepped on stage. She would write her works, and then I would go somewhere, and then I would perform them. And that's really kind of how my acting got started, by delivering her pieces. But since I already had a natural love for it, and she was doing it all the time, it just kind of cultivated. And yeah, and then it just became a passion of mine. And so initially, I kind of started off the way she did. I was writing poetry, and I was writing plays and that sort of thing. And like I said, I went to the performing arts high school, and they encouraged it. And then eventually, when I went to college, I got a degree in journalism. That was actually, it really wasn't because I was interested in journalism. So sorry to my alma mater, but it's because I was firmly entrenched in the industry by then, but my mom really wanted to make sure that I had a college degree. My mother was an educator. And so when I was thinking about what my major would be, I was thinking, what could I do for 4 years and still feel that kind of fire burn within me? And so it was writing. And so I decided to do journalism. And I said, well, let me see, how close can I get to this being performing? So I did broadcast journalism. And it wasn't until grad school that I actually learned how to write for film, because my graduate degree is in film from Florida State. So it just, it was kind of step by step. And then one day that became part of my resume.
And you were really moving around through most of that period of your life.
I was definitely, definitely.
So when did you settle? I mean, you're based in LA now.
Yes,
Okay, when did
yes.
you settle in LA?
I moved to Los Angeles after grad school, and my intention, like I said, I have an MFA in film, was to do all of it. I'd been acting all my life, I know. I'd been acting pretty much all of my life at that point, and now I had a degree in film, and at Florida State, they don't let you pigeonhole yourself. So you learn about screenwriting, and you also learn about editing, and you also learn about cinematography, and you also learn about directing and sound design. And so I had kind of all those tools working for me. So I thought, I am a filmmaker. So I thought, I'll go out to LA and I'll act and I'll make films and it'll be great. I'm gonna hyphen it. I come from the theater. So the idea of having, more than one skill set is what you're supposed to have. But when I got to LA, they didn't think so. They thought, oh, you just don't know what you want to do. You're not focused. You should make a decision. And I said, I did, all of them. And yeah, that wasn't flying. So I purposely stepped away from acting for a while because I felt like I had a base in that. And I wanted to build up my resume as a writer and director, which are the kind of the two mediums that really at that point felt the most organic for me. So that's what I did. I stepped away from acting, and I did a bit of directing, but I did a lot more writing, and that's what kind of rose to the top. And once I felt like I had my footing there, I clued people in that I could also be in front of the camera, and now I do both.
Wow. So how did you start the writing and directing professionally? Because that's a tough leap. Let's not skip over those details.
Okay. The directing, like I said, when I said I did a little bit of it, it was independent projects. So I did some short films. I did like a couple of music videos for friends. And I still enjoy doing it, but I just gravitated more toward the writing. And for the writing, a bit of an interesting story, actually. So before I actually after I graduated from Florida State, I started writing kind of my first post-college screenplay. And I had written maybe a third of it, maybe. I think that might be generous. But then when I got out to LA, I found, your 9-to-5 job. It was in the industry, so I was working as an assistant to two executives at Viacom. And so I felt like I was still kind of in the mix. But I found it very difficult to do the writing outside of work hours thing, try to do it before work or after I got home. I was just tired, and I didn't feel energized enough to write the script. And I know people do it, and I have so much respect for them. It was not working for me. And so I had been in this job for some months. I can't remember at this point. And I just felt like I wasn't doing what I was supposed to be doing. I was like, I have this screenplay and it's unfinished. And why is it unfinished, while I'm doing this other job that's important for other people's careers, but not for my own. So one day I'm driving into work, and I think my commute was like an hour and a half. And I call my mom, and I say to her, I say, Mom, I don't know. I think I'm about to do something a little silly. And I always went to my mom for advice. And I said, I think I'm about to ask for a leave of absence to finish my screenplay. And I fully expected her to, much the same way she said, okay, be reasonable, go to college, make sure you have this. I expected her to say, okay, be reasonable, stay in your job, don't rock the boat because you need that to survive. But she was immediately and surprisingly supportive of me asking for some time off. And in fact, I told her, I said, I think maybe 4 weeks. She said, maybe six. I was like, okay, mom, sure. So I went into work and I went into my boss's office and I said, I need to finish the screenplay. Like I have to for me, for my sanity. And they were amazingly supportive as well. And they said, okay, I tell you what, you find someone to sit at your desk for 6 weeks and you go finish your screenplay.
Wow.
And so I found them some. I found a friend who needed a job and she took my place. And I drove up to my sister's place in the Bay Area and just wrote day after day. And I finished the screenplay the day before I was supposed to return to work. Yeah, it was kind of crazy. I go into work and I sit down at my desk and I know I'm not supposed to be there.
Wow.
And so I stood up and I went back into my boss's office and I gave 30 days notice.
Wow.
And I know. Yeah, it wasn't a great conversation because they've been really great to me. We're good now. Our friendship is back on track. But for a second, things were a little iffy. Mm-hmm. But 2 weeks after that happened, one of my former classmates from undergrad, and I'll backtrack a little bit. When I was in undergrad, this classmate, a couple of classmates, decided to make an independent film. And so I was in the film as an actress. And it's kind of one of the things that sparked my curiosity about filmmaking, because I had done television and I had done theater, but I had not done film. And it was really a big factor in why I decided to pursue an MFA in film. Anyway, so going back, one of those classmates called because he was now a producer and he said, I hear you're writing. To this day, I have no idea who told him that I was writing. I don't think that I had blasted it on any kind. That wasn't quite the social media mecca that it is now. But so I said, well, yeah, I am. He said, well, I've got this project. I've got this idea. We're looking for a writer. I'm coming out to LA. Let's have breakfast. Bring me a writing sample and let's see whether or not you're the person. And I handed him the script that I had finished 2 weeks prior. And that was my first professional writing job.
Wow. Wow. So, I mean, that's not supposed to happen that quickly. That's a nice.
No. Yeah. It was a little different. Yeah. It was a little different. And it was really about timing. And I think about risking, you know, it was a risk to ask my boss for some time off. It was, I mean, all of it is, you know, I think that, and I've said this to people many times over when they ask about advice in the industry and this sort of thing. And I just say, you know, that the exponential moments of growth that I have seen in my career in whatever area have always followed some sort of big risk, have always followed some sort of step off of the cliff.
Yeah.
And so I try to remember that when I start feeling a little complacent or when I start feeling comfortable, I think that the growth comes in the discomfort. And so I just try to remember these moments for future moments.
Yes, that's a great call. I'm thinking of this story of Melissa McCarthy at one point, who was working as an assistant and quit her job so she could, quote unquote, focus on acting.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if that ever worked out for her, but
I don't know. I don't know. We should Google it.
Yeah. But yeah, there's that element of risk is really important for most people. Few people kind of rung up the ladder one step at a time.
Mm-hmm. This is very true.
So you took a leap and it seems to have paid off. What happened on that first job?
That first job was the first feature also that I had produced, which is Motives.
Nice.
Yeah, it went really well. I wrote it and that it was produced by Sony, and then we did a sequel. It went well.
That's amazing. Okay. What did you learn doing that first movie? Because that's the first professional job. Sony's involved. This is mm-hmm. not some small indie. Now you're really playing with the big boys.
Right. Wow, what did I learn? So many things. I mean, because the entire process was so foreign to me. But again, it wasn't typical. I mean, so I'm hired to write the film, and they wanted a quick turnaround. They wanted the entire draft in 30 days, and you know, it had taken me forever just to get that first post film school screenplay done. So I was like, wait, you want everything like in 30 days? And that includes the outline and okay. So I went back up to my sister's place.
Wow.
That became like my writing retreat.
Right. It worked once.
And just like wrote all the time. But because I think initially, I'm not really sure the studio expected much of the film. You know, it was one of their lower budget projects, and so I had a lot of autonomy because they just kind of wanted the production company to turn in the product, so to speak. So I had a lot more to say about the direction of the story. I mean, certainly, listen, they had their hands in it, so there are some things that to this day I might have done differently. I might have said differently. The story might have gone another direction, but that's another interview. But I do feel like I had a chance, at least for that first draft, to just write what I thought worked as a story. And having had experiences since then, that's just not always a luxury that you have. So that first time out, wrote it, we shot it, and again, I think expectations were low. And then once it was produced, it resonated, and that's why, we kind of came back with a sequel. And that was a very different process. I think I might have learned more from the sequel than I did from the original, because I mistakenly thought that first experience was how it usually goes. And then I learned, oh, no, not at all. And at this point, by the time they came to me for the sequel, I had actually returned to the film school as a visiting professor in screenwriting. So now I'm teaching screenwriting, and I'm writing a script for a studio. And I don't think I slept for months. There were times I legitimately thought I was out of my mind. I remember once, actually, I'm having, I don't know, I would think I was just having coffee. And so I get a phone call from Sony. And they didn't call me directly much. They usually spoke with me through the production company. So I had had so little sleep, and I was trying to juggle so many things at once that when I saw on the caller ID that the call was from Sony, I don't know, I short-circuited. I was like, why are they calling me? I was like, there was like some conspiracy. I was getting fired. Like, I had no idea what was going on, and I didn't want to answer the phone. And finally, I'm like, hello. So it was fine, not a fire. They did want to talk story, but that was a very challenging way to write a script. One, in the way that it normally goes, where there are a lot of cooks in the kitchen, and then also, because when you're teaching screenwriting, it's not like you're marking an answer, yes, right or wrong, or it's app. It's literally about going in and dissecting people's story and character and structure, and I'm trying to do that also. It was a lot. It was a lot. It was definitely a learning experience.
Yeah, why did you take on that professor role if you, I mean, you're a professional writer, what made you jump into that too?
Timing. When the dean came to me, again, I stayed in. When I was at Florida State, he was one of my professors, and then in the kind of time between, he actually became the dean, and we kept in contact. And whenever he would come out to LA, we'd have breakfast or whatever. And I thought it was just one of those, normal meals we have when he was on the West Coast, and he kind of threw it out there. He said, "How would you feel about coming and teaching for a year?" And in that moment, it was just a good time for me to get out of the city. It had, after a while, I kind of needed to decompress a bit from the LA life. I didn't have any projects going on right at that time. And I said, yeah, sure, I'll come out for a year. Why not? And then it was after I was already there that that I heard that they wanted to do a sequel for Motives. And so it just kind of all happened at once.
Wow, that's awesome. So what happened then? I mean, did you started booking a lot of roles in TV. So how did that transition go?
Well, so I, like I said, I'd been out here and I had put acting to the side. And I mean, listen, I would sneak off every once in a while and do like a play. It was almost like getting like my artistic hit. But I was still really focusing on writing and directing. And then when I came back from teaching at Florida State, I decided it was time to come back to acting. That I just missed it. And I just, it had always been in my bones and in my spirit. And I felt like at this point in my life also, I was strong enough to combat those people who had opinions about how I should direct my life and direct my career. So I think when I first got out, I was pretty wet behind the ears, and somebody said, no, this isn't how you do it. I just believed them. But at this point, I had just grown as a person and grown as an artist and grown in my belief in myself, and I figured it's time for me to do things the way that I think are right for me. And so when I came back, I had to kind of start from scratch.
Wow.
Because I had been out of the game for a minute. So I didn't have an agent. I didn't have a headshot. I didn't have anything. Wow. Yeah, no, it was like I had never had a career. And I mean, it's no secret that you can be cold after a couple of months. Now imagine years. So yeah, I started from scratch. I started doing background work. Mm. And I managed to walk in to an agency who it was an agent of a friend of mine, and he said, "You know, I'm going to go by, I'm going to talk to my agent. Why don't you just come with me? Don't ask him anything. Don't say you want an agent. Just come with me." I said, "Okay." And so I just came with him to this visit to the agent, and we were all just kind of talking. And after it was over, I left. I get a phone call from my friend. He says, "So my agent wants to talk to you." I said, "Really?" And that's how I got kind of back in the game for an agent. But even then, it took a year to get my first audition. It took a year for him to get me in the room. And luckily, I booked that first one.
Wow.
But it was, it really was starting completely over. And then I really have just built it up block by block since then.
Wow. So let's talk a little bit about your writing process, about how you start a script, how you start an outline. What do you do first when you have a new idea or a new assignment?
It depends on whether or not it's something that's from me, or whether or not it's a commissioned work. For me, an idea can come from anywhere. And I mean, sometimes the idea is a character and not even the story, and I build the story around the character. I once wrote a screenplay based on an idea for a scene. I wanted a husband and wife to be embroiled, and I wanted her to say, "Who is she?" And for him to say, "I don't know," and for him to be telling the truth. And so I try to figure out, how can that be a true conversation? And that's how that entire screenplay came. And I believe in the outline process, because I think that if you map it out that way, you can see a lot of the weaknesses or a lot of the gaps before you get into the process. Because I'm not a fast writer, which is another reason why I found myself needing to go to a quote-unquote writer's retreat when I'm on a deadline.
Hmm.
Because I like to sit with it. Sometimes it's difficult. I'll be writing a scene, and I'm looking for that perfect word. And if I can't find it, I honestly can't move on. I can't do it. And so I'll sit on this scene all day long because I can't find the word that I want. So yeah, so deadlines, I work well with deadlines, but they stress me out a bit. So when I'm writing for myself, actually when I'm writing for other people too, but definitely when I'm writing for myself, I think the outline process is really important. And that's where I try to head a lot of the issues off at the pass. And then I follow my own recipe. I mean, once you have the outline and you've shifted that around and done as much as you can do, by the time I'm done with an outline, it's almost the script. I start out pretty simply with the scene heading and the scene description. And then if a piece of dialogue comes to me, I'll add that, because I don't want to forget it. Or if a moment comes to me, or if a way of expressing a certain moment in terms of the description, I'll put that in there. So they start off as a sentence or two for a scene, but they usually end up pretty thick paragraphs. And then when it's time to write, a lot of it is removing those scene headings and then making the rest of it work.
Wow, removing the scene headings. That's a great tip. What about your characters? How do you start those? How do you develop those? At what stage do you develop those?
Again, it depends on whether or not the story started with the character or it started with the plot.
Hmm.
If it started with the plot, generally I spend, and this is interesting, generally I spend more time developing the character if it started with the plot, because I don't ever want to create a story that's about plot. I think that should come from the character. So I'm really careful to go back in and make sure that the character is dimensional so that it doesn't feel like they're pawns to the storyline. And if it starts with the character, I usually have some sort of emotional connection there in the first place. And so while the development still happens, a lot of it feels a lot more organic. And then it's really about, okay, so I know this person. Now what would they do for real? You know, not worried about the plot, just what makes sense to them based on who they are.
Okay. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Do you borrow from real life?
Again, it depends. But yes, I mean, yes, I mean, we all do. I mean, we're a composite of our experiences. But yeah, I definitely, and there's definitely an author character in everything that I write, even things that that were not my original idea. And I was, you know, commissioned to write them. But yeah, I pull from real life a lot. I used to carry around like a little notebook. Now I just do it on my phone. But I'm always an observer of what's happening around me. So they'll just be, someone will say something and I'm like, oh man, that's amazing dialogue. I never would have thought to say it that way. And so I'll write that down, or I'll see something, or, you know, someone will do something and it will just, I'll think, oh, what a wonderful character moment. Like one time I saw this man, he's smoking a cigarette and he's outside and he's by one of those exterior ashtrays, the big kind of like stone ones. And so he finishes the cigarette and he puts it out on the ground next to the ashtray, like he's next to the ashtray. And he decides he would rather put his cigarette out on the ground. And I was like, that's a great character moment. And I wrote it down. Or I was in a bookstore once, and there was this little girl. And it's not a bookstore, a shoe store once. And there was this little girl, and she had taken a shoebox, and she was walking down the aisle of the shoe store, holding the shoebox like you would a birthday cake, singing happy birthday because she was playing make believe. I was like, how cute is that? I wrote that down. You know, so I just figured there are all these moments where, sure, you might come up with them on your own, but sometimes you don't have to.
Yeah, sometimes you don't. Mm-hmm. There's a parallel set of questions I'd like to ask, and that is one, directing, and the other, acting. But how have those other paths informed you as a writer?
Amazingly so. I certainly write for actors. it's actually informed on both sides. Like as an actor, I have a reverence for the script. Part of that is because I started in theater, where the script is the Bible and you don't change a word, which I learned later is also in television. Film gives you, there's a lot more kind of leniency in that. But generally, as an actor, I have a huge reverence for the script. And then as a writer, I try to exist more in the silence. So for me, it's much more important what's not being said than what is being said. And so I feel like especially for works that were things that I came up with and I have, you know, creative control over how they're expressed, I trust the actor. I try not to put a lot of unnecessary dialogue. It's much more about a look and about a moment and what the actions are about. And then that says it. Because I find that a lot of times when I'm being hired to write something, I'll write it that way. And then they'll say, well, I want to make sure that the audience gets it. So let's say this. And I'm like, I think the audience will get it. I don't think that you need to spell it out that way. Mm-hmm. I usually lose that battle. But I try, because I really think that that's where the meat is. The meat is in the silence.
Oh, that's a great pull quote. The meat is in the silence.
Nice.
That's fantastic. Well, as we wrap up here, I'd like to ask one big question is, what would you tell the younger, just starting out Kelsey Scott to do differently when now that you know, you have a little more experience, a little more wisdom about the business, a little bit more about writing? What advice would you give your former self?
I think I would just tell her to trust herself. On both sides of the camera, I'm in a position where other people's opinions determine whether or not I work, whether or not I eat. And so sometimes you get into this place where your desire to please usurps the reason you were hired in the first place. You had to have had some sort of skill set for them to decide that you were the one to express this creativity. And I think you have to not forget that in the throes of it. You got hired for this part because they thought that you could interpret this script. You got hired for this script because they thought that you could craft this world. And it's very easy to doubt that in the melee. And so I think I would just tell her, sit, be still, and trust yourself.
Wow. That's a great place for us to leave it, Kelsey. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
That was Kelsey Scott joining us on Write On by Final Draft. Do you like Write On by Final Draft? Because if you do, it would be great to have your thoughts on iTunes or wherever you get your podcast. Leave us a review or a rating. Until next time, I'm Pete D'Alessandro. Write On.